Belinda and Harper Audio Australia present this unabridged recording of Don't Look Away, a memoir of identity and acceptance, written by Danielle Laidley and Conrad Marshall, and read by Rebecca Macauley. For my children, this story is for you, in the hope that one day we will walk together again, side by side. I love you. Always have. Always will. This book deals with suicide and drug abuse. If you or a person you know is in need of crisis or suicide prevention support, call Lifeline on 131114 or visit lifeline.org.au/get help. Foreword by Craig Silvey. I have an enduring memory of Danielle Laidley. Midway through the 2006 AFL season, which had been a disappointing one for the North Melbourne Football Club, a verbal confrontation took place in the stands between Danielle, who was then head coach, and a furious spectator. A few hours later, that same spectator took their own life. At the time, beyond reflecting on the tragedy, I recall being dismayed by the willingness of the press to connect the two events as though Danielle's outburst had been in any way causative. Despite being absolved of blame by the spectator's family and the broader community, by all appearances it took an emotional toll on Danielle. She looked haunted addressing the media the following day. I was moved by the sincerity of her response and the sorrow she expressed. But what I remember most is what she had said to the spectator. It seemed at odds with the hostility of the exchange in the stands. It was an invitation. "Come down to the rooms," she had said. "Come and see how we're all hurting." To my interpretation, Danielle had extended the offer so the spectator could see that he wasn't alone, that they were all human. All fighting towards a common purpose, all sharing the same frustrations, all capable of fragility. It was a respectful and compassionate gesture, and it put everyone on equal footing. In acknowledging the spectator's pain, Danielle was saying that she understood it, because she felt it too. After a family member of mine intervened in the attempted suicide of a young trans person, I was inspired to better educate myself as to the challenges and pressures faced by trans and gender diverse people in Australia. I was alarmed by the high incidences of depression and anxiety and self-harm, deeply concerned by the disproportionate exposure to violence, and heartbroken by the prevalent rates of attempted suicide. It struck me as a crisis, and it still does. I began writing a novel about a young trans character called Honeybee, who steps onto a quiet overpass in the middle of the night and looks down at a fatal abyss. It's a bleak beginning to a book, but I was seeking to answer an optimistic question. How might this person climb back over the rail and make their way towards a safer, more hopeful path? Through my research and consultation with members of the community, I came to understand how the presence of support, love, acceptance, safety, and allyship immeasurably improved outcomes for trans and gender diverse people. I wanted cisgender readers to be inspired by this. I hoped they might reflect on the extent to which our cisnormative social order has marginalized and undermined the progress of trans people, and how we all have a responsibility to correct that injustice. But my principal ambition in writing Honeybee was to give trans and gender diverse readers the opportunity to feel seen and respected and galvanized and truly represented. I'm proud to say that far beyond any prize or plaudit, the most profound reward of my writing life has been the opportunity to hear responses from trans and gender diverse readers to whom Honeybee has given comfort and courage. One of those very generous readers was Danielle Laidley, and I'll forever be grateful for her friendship. Like many Australians, I have enormous admiration for Danielle Laidley. Throughout her many careers, we have seen her leadership, her strength, her ferocious courage, her conviction, her generosity, her passion, her honesty. But there have been aspects of her life that we haven't seen. Much of what has defined Danielle has been deeply private, not just concealed from public view, but obscured from her own understanding too. For previous generations of trans people, finding a language and a conceptual framework to process their feelings of dysphoria was often impossible. Outside queer, academic, and progressive communities, meaningful discussions around gender identity did not exist. They certainly couldn't be heard in the back blocks of Balga or in our mainstream sporting culture. And for many, contending with these issues in solitude often amplified the confusion and widened the disconnection and deepened the internalized shame. This is why the clarity of a clinical diagnosis, the euphoria of self-actualization, and the introduction of acceptance and support can provide such relief. It's also why books like this one are so vital and valuable. Much of Danielle's memoir is about recontextualizing her past, but it's also a reclamation of her narrative. After her truth as a trans woman was cruelly and disgracefully publicized without her consent, Danielle was again unable to control the perception of her own identity. Until now. These are her words. They are powerful, they are inspiring, and just like in 2006, they are an invitation. Once again, Danielle is asking us to come and see. To come and see how she has hurt. To come and see how she has triumphed. To come and see how she has endured heartbreak and backbreak. How she has self-medicated and how she has healed. How she has lost herself and found herself. She's inviting trans and gender diverse readers and listeners to come and see that they are not alone, that they need not feel afraid or ashamed, that they are loved, that they matter, that there is hope. She's inviting cisgender readers and listeners to come and see a proud trans woman navigating the world with pride and purpose. To come and see the discrimination she has experienced and how she has faced these obstacles with dignity and humility. To come and see how her story is emboldening and saving lives. She's inviting us all to come and see things as she's seen them, to feel things as she's felt them, to live them as she's lived them, raw and confronting as it may often be. Come and see. And don't look away. This moment scares me. I live in Kilmurry Way, a hook-shaped street in the suburb of Balga, in the hardscrabble, sunburnt flatlands north of Perth. I'm 6 years old, and I don't know it yet, but this is the first place I will remember in life. Our block is huge, or seems that way to me. In the corner of the front yard is one of those massive pampas grass plants, a big, ugly, circular clump of long serrated leaves bowing outwards like sabres, with a few feathery flower things sprouting straight up out of the centre. There's a weeping willow too, in the middle of the lawn. I like lying on the thick grass under its ropey yellow-green branches as they dangle and sway. The driveway is a thin layer of tar on the ground, and it gets sticky in the summer until it slowly melts away to the orange dirt and rock beneath. The backyard is bare, a plain expanse with a squat concrete shed and a hulking gum tree in one corner. I have to tilt my body back 45 degrees to see the eucalyptus canopy. The brick house itself is nothing to look at. A lounge at the front feeding three bedrooms on one side and a kitchen on the other are dunning out the back. I'm afraid to go for a wee in the middle of the night, scared a redback will have crawled in there and under the toilet seat from the pile of logs sitting next to the lav, the logs we feed into the wood heater, which gives us our hot water. My memory of this age is patchy, and that's being generous. Happy vignettes are few and far between. I want to see this time in my life clearly, but my recall is cloudy. I get a flash of Crawley Bay, a cove on the Swan River with a private yacht club and public jetties near Pelican Point, where we go to splash and swim and catch prawns for a cheap dinner. I see people setting up streamers on walls at the Wanneroo Football Club for a cabaret night that ends in slurred arguments and fistfights. Some things are vivid like that, but Kilmurry Way is a special kind of nothingness, filled with silence and something unsettled. I see the yellow seagrass tiles on top of the lino in the kitchen. I see wood-panelled walls in some rooms and funky paisley wallpaper in others. I can't see my bedroom or the bathroom. I cannot see my father or mother or little brother. I see clearly only the lounge room and the lady with the red lipstick. The lady with the red lipstick is surrounded by other ladies her age, young or youngish. They sit in a circle by the fireplace, near the door onto the veranda. It's daytime, hot, and I don't know why these women are here. This lady at the centre of everything is attractive, blonde, and I can't tell if she has an accent or just speaks differently, but to me, she seems cosmopolitan, chic, posh, though I don't yet know these words. From inside a deep bag, she takes out a range of nail polishes and holds them up to the light, displaying each colour for the ladies. She waits for approving murmurs as she shows them coral orange and burnt orange, then lime green and mossy green. I see the women sampling, admiring the new paint jobs they've just given their fingertips. I watch them laugh and titter and swap gossip, and I hear it all because little piggies have big ears. I watch it all from the corner of the room, silent and unseen. And while I don't know what any of this is exactly, I know it is exactly what I want. I wait until near the end of the display, when all the buying is done and my mum and her friends and the lady with the red lipstick are sitting around having nibbles and wine. I feel like a hungry rat now, waiting for a chance to sneak the cheese. The lipsticks and eyeshadow and nail polish and blush and foundation cover our coffee table, so I find my way to the floor, still silent, still unseen, and sit for a moment, furtive but with a plan. I inch closer, bum scooting softly across the carpet. Closer still, close enough to touch. I swipe a bottle, stick it in my pocket, stand calmly, walk down the hallway and, I'm not sure why, turn straight into my mother's room. I try to copy what I remember from the demonstration out in the lounge. With my dominant left hand, I draw the tiny brush from the bottle, like a sword from a stone, and delicately stroke the first fingernail on my right hand with paint. I do a toenail too. Bright red, rose red, Coca-Cola red, McDonald's red, Heinz red, strawberry red, Santa red. A thick red layer, firming and shining before my eyes. I blow on it, just like the woman did. I twist and turn the finger, twirling it like a conductor, and bend it at the knuckle to face me, just like the woman did. I tilt it into the light slowly, not quite sure what I'm admiring, but admiring it all the same. I breathe deeply, and I sigh. Life often feels hostile to me, but not right now. Right now, I feel only calm. I feel warm. I smile. I go to touch my handiwork and the surface has stiffened. The paint is hardened like a ceramic shell. I pick at it for a moment, expecting it to flake and fall, but it's not coming off. I scratch it harder, but it's fully set, like chrome over steel. This feels like something from a film, where someone is trapped behind glass and they punch it and hurl furniture at it, but it won't break. And eventually they unholster their gun and impotently shoot rounds at the bulletproof surface. but I'm not a man behind bulletproof glass. I'm a boy in my mum's room, wearing stolen red nail polish. And so I panic, utterly and completely. I bolt out the back. I'm on my knees now in the far corner of the yard, in the shade of that massive gum tree, rubbing my finger with water from a brass garden tap.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.